Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Talk for this morning, and I'm greatly appreciative for him stepping in and filling, being willing to take this spot on short notice. Vladimir Safonov, you're live. Vladimir Safonov received his master's degree with excellence at St. Petersburg University in 1977, candidate of sciences degree in 1982, doctor of sciences degree in 1991, and professor degree in 1994. He's been with St. Petersburg University of Russia, the Russian Federation, for 28 years. His areas of expertise include Microsoft's .NET architecture, aspect-oriented programming, programming languages, compilers, Java technology, and knowledge management. His talk today focuses on his work in creating aspect.NET, an aspect-oriented programming tool for .NET.
Thank you for introduction. So, good morning, everybody. My pleasure to introduce our Aspect.NET project at this seminar. So, the goals of the project was and is to develop a state-of-the-art aspect-oriented programming environment for Microsoft.NET on top of the latest Microsoft tools and technologies. Phoenix and Whidbey, and also develop a version of ASP.NET working in SSCLI environment. Actually, the main goal, speaking informally, is to make AOP really ubiquitous for Microsoft.NET software developers and users. So I do think that AOP is still in research stage, and there are still tutorials on AOP at each conference like OPSLA and so on. But I do think that AOP should be made ubiquitous as object-oriented programming now. So this is the goal of my research and goal of our project. It is very challenging, but I think it should be done. Then theoretical and methodological goal was also to develop and investigate the most adequate ways of representing aspects for Microsoft.NET, because really I do know right now that there are probably hundreds of research projects devoted to AOP implementation for Microsoft.NET. I think that we have chosen a correct approach. At least I have consulted to Gregor Kitsalis, the founder of AOP, and he approved of my approach in person. Of course, we are hoping to continue our project and thus lay the foundation for future theoretical research and development work on aspect-oriented knowledge engineering, knowledge management, and so on, and of course development work on spreading, popularizing AOP among Microsoft.NET users. So actually, some words about origin of AOP. AOP is a very prospective software engineering paradigm based on the concept of cross-cutting concern. So cross-cutting concern is a kind of idea or concern or consideration or functionality to be introduced to some application or to be woven to some application in terms of AOP. This functionality cannot be expressed only as a related set of modules, class hierarchy, procedure, function, and macros, and so on, but also requires inserting or adding to target application some tangled code fragments to different pieces of the application. Actually, interesting fact, probably not known to some of you, that there were many predecessors of AOP, because the ideas of AOP are quite natural. So because AOP is being used probably non-consciously by all of us each day, so each day we need to locate where the bug is, to locate where the pieces of code is to be fixed when fixing some bug. And it is really sometimes a problem for programmers. One of the predecessors of AOP was Professor Adolf Fuchsmann from Rostov University, from our country. And his pioneering book, Technological Aspects of Software System Development, was published in 1979 in Russia. Unfortunately, it was not translated into English. But please note that the word aspect is present in the header of the book. It was in 1979. When I asked Gregor, does he know that fact? He said, no, sorry. But actually, of course, right now, the well-known modern classicist of AOP is Professor Gregor Kicharis, now working at University of British Columbia and originating Aspect J tool in mid-1990s in Xerox PARC company. Actually, AOP basics are shown on this slide. So cross-cutting concern, I already explained what it is. So examples of cross-cutting concerns, typical ones, are logging, of course, security considerations, empty safety, adding empty safety to any library. And so probably example, the most close to compiler developers like me is just suppose we are to implement or to add some new feature to source language of the compiler, adding generics to C-sharp and so on. So, and everything which is needed to be added to the compiler to do that is an aspect. So the idea of that is cross-cutting concern and implementation of that is an aspect. Aspect is an implementation of cross-cutting concern, and weaving is applying an aspect to a target application. So, which means not only adding some set of modules, but also adding references to them, calls to them, probably some declarations or definitions, and calls of these modules as a tangled pieces of code into the target application. Point cut is a kind of rule set. So I'm also doing knowledge management, and I do think that point cut can be considered as a rule set or production set, which describes weaving rules for some aspect or a set of aspects. Then join points are a set of concrete points found or located in a target application subject to aspect weaving. But one of the problems, I will tell you about it much more, blind weaving to join points is very dangerous. And so in our tool, this shortage has been overcome. I will tell you about that. But great benefits of AOP is AOP really makes software development and maintenance easier. So it really makes easier day-to-day activity of any software developers. But of course, there are a lot of similar approaches like generative programming, metaprogramming, and so on. But actually, I think AOP is just not in the state of cradle, but it is probably a very young age, and even the basic terms of AOP are sometimes understandable by different researchers in different way. What is our approach to AOP? From the very beginning, my goal was to invent the best way to represent aspects for Microsoft.NET, and of course to use all advantages of .NET approach to programming. It means for the first turn, aspects should be made language agnostic or multi-language in accordance to .NET programming paradigm, of course, as opposed to most of the existing and even such well-known AOP tools as Aspect J, because most of them are really just extensions of Java or some concrete programming language. So it means in particular that aspects are mixed up to classes. Classes can inherit from aspects. Aspects can inherit from classes and so on. But I do think that aspects and aspect is much more general notion, is a kind of meta knowledge. So it does make sense to have aspects in production language like Prolog, in functional language, in procedural language, in object-oriented language, and so on. It means, from my viewpoint, that aspects should be done multi-language. And that's why I developed and we are using a very, very simple AOP meta language, whose working name is aspect.net.ml. From meta-language. Actually, it is a kind of a set of AOP annotations to source code. So if you don't like AOP, you can just ignore them and replace them by comments. So just put two slashes at the beginning of each line and program as usual. But if you like AOP, so you can use these annotations and our tool. So another advantage of Microsoft.NET from viewpoint of our project is custom attributes. Custom attributes is already mentioned, are already mentioned in other talks. They're a very comfortable way of annotating source code and annotating assemblies in .NET. And in particular, we decided to use custom attributes, aspect-def and aspect-ref, to represent aspects. They are very simple, actually, a kind of structures. The advantage of this approach is they are tied to assemblies. They cannot be lost at all. And these attributes are recognizable and usable by our tool, but they are just not noticeable by other tools. And so any other tools like debuggers, Visual Studio, and so on and so on, should not be modified at all to use AOP. So my initial consideration when I started this project that probably I should make Rotor or .NET Framework AOP aware. No. So using this approach, it should not be done. So just use custom attributes and use them and modify them by our tool. And so it doesn't prevent from normal working using ordinary, well-known Microsoft tools like Whitby, for example. So another idea was to use Phoenix to handle assemblies. Actually, our aspects can be described and viewed at the source code level, but actually, essentially, aspects do exist and are handled at the assembly level. So actually, it means that you can represent aspects written in ILASM or ILDASM or just binaries, assemblies. So we needed a tool to handle assemblies. There were a lot of such tools, but they were very specialized. And we preferred to wait until the version of Phoenix, which will be described in detail in the next talk by Microsoft. So Phoenix will appear, such version that it could be really useful for handling .NET assemblies. Actually, we got this version of Phoenix in March this year only. So the previous versions of Phoenix couldn't actually work with assemblies. But so right now we have a great version of Phoenix. And in a few months we develop working prototypes of our system based on Phoenix. So due to Phoenix, we need not reinvent a wheel, and so develop our own applications to handle the bits of RVAs and so PE files and so on. Phoenix does it perfectly well. And so we use Phoenix to handle assemblies, and in particular it means that we use Phoenix IR, which is high level enough to handle. So one of the primary goals of Weaver, of course it is well understandable, is to handle, to insert some elements, to insert some code. It is not very comfortable to do at the level of file code, of course, but it is very comfortable to do at the level of Phoenix IR. So this is one of the reasons why we use Phoenix. So actually, another important idea was to develop our tool by aspect.net as an add-in to Whitby, to the latest version of Microsoft Visual Studio .NET 2005 Beta 2. We're using this version. So to closely integrate it to the latest Microsoft software development technologies. Actually, it means that our aspect.net, and I will show it to you in a moment, is started at the same time together with Whitby. So when we just double-click some solution file, so Whitby started and our aspect.net console is started. And so if you are not using AOP, you can just ignore it. If you are using AOP, you can use our console and our tools together with Whitby. So there are a lot of other approaches to AOP. So I already mentioned the first of them, language extensions of some specific language, like Java primarily, as in AspecJ and many other Aspect-oriented tools. So it should be mentioned also the IBM HyperJ, very complicated system based on the concept of multidimensional separation of concerns. So then interceptors, it was one of the approaches by Microsoft researchers mentioned in some of the articles in MSDN magazine. Interceptors means replacing, dynamically replacing one calls to other calls, so or inserting some into the chain of method calls, calls to some methods who provide the OP. It is being dynamically and probably not quite understandable at the source code level and so on. Then another approach, like in Weave.net, developed in Dublin in Trinity College, is just to take AspecJ-like specifications and to insert them or convert them into the form of XML files. But it is great, but the danger of this approach is so that XML files can be just lost, and they may not travel together with assemblers, and so they are not integrated to assemblers, actually. Then there is a dynamic aspects approach. In this approach, aspects are a kind of debugger breakpoints. So it means that the conditions of applying aspects and the aspects themselves are constructed and are determined at runtime. It is great, but it's sometimes not reliable and not understandable. So our approach, I already explained it. As far as I can judge right now, there is no other AOP tool so closely integrated to Microsoft technologies as Aspect.net. Probably it is too early for my side to say so, but because I just uploaded the first prototype of Aspect.net. But so we hope for a good future and prospective future of our project. It is not all we did, of course. Then some words about Aspect.net architecture. based on our approach, we need, of course, initially we have a file whose extension is .an from aspect.net. This is source code annotated to aspect.net.ml annotations. And of course, we have a converter currently for C# and in near future for Visual Basic and other .NET languages to convert these extended sources to ordinary sources in C#. And I will show them in the demo. So these ordinary sources will just contain attribute definitions in square brackets, like quite common in C#, instead of these annotations. Then we have, of course, an aspect weaver, which takes a target assembly and one or more aspect assemblies and provides modified or woven or updated version of the target assembly. Then we have an aspect GUI, aspect editor. It currently allows to visualize aspects to view or visualize the points, the join points subject to aspect viewing, and so on. And it is closely integrated to Widby as an add-in. we have developed, and I have uploaded, an MSI-based installer of Aspect.net system. But please note that Phoenix is available via Microsoft Phoenix Academic Program under special license. It means that, of course, our installer and our package I had uploaded doesn't contain any bit of Phoenix. So what our installer does is it is just checks where Phoenix RDK was installed on your machine and asks you to point a directory where Phoenix RDK is located. Then we also developed Aspect Router. Aspect Router is a separate version of Aspect.net for router environment. It means that, of course, Weaver is the same. The main modules are also the same, but interface is different. So we developed, I think, comfortable enough user interface based on just console working, menus in console mode, because so we know that router doesn't have Windows forms. This is an example probably the simplest aspect. Let's make any application polite. It means that it says hello after the call, each call, and says bye at the end, or before, sorry, hello before each call and bye after each call. So this is a description or definition of the aspect in our meta language. In yellow are aspect.net ML annotations. So name of the aspect, modules, and the rules. So actually, I consider my viewpoint on aspect is aspect is, should have a, so is a structure which has its name, probably parameters, or aspects can be generic, at least the future releases of aspect.net. Then the aspect can have data, modules, and rules, weaving rules. So weaving rules consist of two parts. The first part is a kind of wildcard or mask or condition. In terms of knowledge management. So this condition enables the weaver to seek possible join points. Where to insert the action? Action is the second part of each rule. And currently action is a method which is described, of course, in ordinary C#. We have two rules. And then this is an example how to weave this aspect using our meta language. But of course, the same is more comfortably done by GUI, by aspect GUI, by aspect editor. This is an example of screenshot aspect.net. You can see aspect.net framework, and so the set of join points you can very comfortably view. And the aspect.net console, where you can trace how aspect.net works. And of course, it is integrated to Whitby Windows and to Whitby GUI. This is a screenshot showing how to color aspects. So when aspects are woven or should be woven into some target application, you can visualize them in such a way. So by clicking, not in this slide, of course, by clicking at some of them, you can view the fragment of the source, which is the join point, and you can analyze. So decide whether to accept this join point or to reject the join point. It is very important. So our system doesn't work blindly. You have a choice, and you can unselect some of the join points, probably as a result of such visualization. What is the current status of aspect.net? I'm very happy that I have a good team of developers, Dmitry Grigoryev, Mikhail Grachev, Alexander Maslennikov, and Oleg Ramashin. They are my PhD students right now. So due to this team, the first working prototype and the console router version of aspect.net was developed recently. So we developed working prototype of aspect.net add-in, or aspect.net framework add-in, as we call it. Then we have developed aspect router, as I mentioned, and I just uploaded aspect.net archive to MSDN Academic Alliance Curriculum Repository website. You should have received email. Please use the latest of them, because MSDN Academic Alliance support people corrected me, so the reference should be as in my latest email. And the archive contains actually aspect.net installer MSI file, aspect router archive, then all the articles published on our project, all the presentations made on our project, and some README files, brief documentation, and of course samples or examples. Perspectives of our aspect.net project, I think, are very good. So actually, of course, we are going to develop a much larger library of useful examples, and probably some of you who are interested in AOP could probably help us to do that in your areas, I mean. So we are going to do further research on aspect-oriented knowledge management and on aspectizing, aspect mining, so to develop and develop an aspectizer part of our system, whose goal is to locate aspects or to extract aspects from non-aspect-oriented programs, non-aspect-oriented applications. And our greatest desire is to get funding from Microsoft to continue our project, to make aspect.net really a product, to be shipped together with some future versions of Visual Studio.net. Of course, it is our dream, and I hope very much that Microsoft will help that this dream come true sometime. This is the list of conferences and seminars where ASP.NET project was presented. So some workshops, of course, in Cambridge and Pisa. And so in Potsdam, I actually was unable to visit that seminar, sorry, but I just sent my presentation. Then Microsoft Academic Days in Moscow this year, IEEE conference in St. Petersburg this year, and Faculty Summit, my presentation on ASP.NET was part of Phoenix panel. And now this seminar, of course, and our current plans. So probably today, tomorrow, I will submit abstract and then a paper to the classical AOP or AOSD conference, the fifth AOP conference in Bonn, Germany, in March next year. this is the list of our evaluators and people who send feedback. This is not complete list, of course, but of course many of them is Microsoft Phoenix team, to whom we are very grateful. John LeFort, Sharok Martazavi, Jim Hawk, and other developers. And there is a commercial company, Mercury Interactive, so international company, which is very interested in perspective and using ASP.NET for the SQE tools and some other commercial development. Of course, I should clarify with Microsoft how to do that, because it is a research project granted by Microsoft Research, but of course it should be negotiated. And so we hope very much that this company will choose our tool. Then there is a university in Brazil interested, some people from Germany, and some other people. So actually, I have just uploaded ASP.NET. I hope for much more users and evaluators, of course. And this is a list of people to whom we are actually or remotely contacted related to our ASP.NET project. So, of course, for the first turns, Gregor Chalice, the founder of AOP, and Andreas Polze from Germany, and Mark Eddy, the Professor Alfred Achos, AOP intern in Phoenix team. I met him on Faculty Summit this summer in Redmond. Then the team of Weave.NET project also, and a team in Hungary doing AOP, a team in Brazil doing AOP, and so on. These are references to our papers. Of course, reference number one is reference to the general AOSD site. We are not yet represented on that site, but I will do that very quickly. Then the next reference is reference of to MSDN Academic Alliance Curriculum Repository website. Object ID is 6219. So actually, it is an ASP.NET archive you can download from this site. And then a series of three articles we published since 2003 until this year in .NET Developers Journal, and an article published in proceedings of our IEEE conference in St. Petersburg this year. So let me first continue with my slides for a few minutes and then make a demo. So if I don't if I don't have enough time to make this demo, because I know I am to finish my talk in a few minutes, I can do it later, so for those who are interested, because so it may require probably 15 minutes to explain everything, and so just to run a couple of examples, because I'm to demonstrate not only ASP.NET framework, but also ASP.router. Then, so installing ASP.NET, so if you are going to use our tool, you should get Phoenix RDK from Microsoft Research, and of course you should install Visual Studio WIDBI Beta 2. And I will skip the details. How to start AOP using our tool? Actually, we have added a special kind of project, so you can add an ASP.NET project using WIDBI. And it means that our tool will provide a skeleton of the code of .an file, so to help you. And you will need to insert appropriate actions and appropriate parts of the ASP.NET. And then when building this solution, so our converter will come into action and will convert this extended source to ordinary C# source annotated with custom attributes related to AOP. then I will skip the details. Then actually, how can it be done? So we, so you should just open some existing project or existing solution. You can build or rebuild this solution. Then you can open solution you create related to some or corresponding to some aspect, build that solution, and then in the first window or the first solution or of target assembly or target application, you can just drag and drop aspect DLL to that window, and so you can visualize the aspect, its parts, I mean join points and actions, and then find join points and edit some of them probably and select some of them if you like. And then view aspects. Everything is done by GUI. So our example of weaving I'm going to show, probably not during this presentation, but later. So we have several examples. Probably the most interesting of them is taken from Phoenix. Phoenix has a set of samples, and one of them is MADNOB, or managed ADNOB. So that application takes some file and inserts a NOP IL instruction after each IL instruction of the original assembly. So, but it is very silent. So, and we instrumented that MADNOP without changing any lines of source code. So due to using aspects. So, and our aspect related to that is called MADNOP counter. So it means that this aspect inserts appropriate actions like tracing, like issuing some messages which explain how Phoenix works, what Phoenix does. And we also count the number of ADNOPs and issue them to the console. So I can show this example to you. I can demo it. We'll have to skip these slides. They explain in detail how to work with aspect.net. The same or similar presentation is uploaded to the curriculum repository website. Some words about aspect router as a conclusion. So this is the first console version of the router environment, and it is included into the aspect.net archive. Actually, right now is a set of Perl scripts. You should use this version of Active Perl, not earlier versions. So, and each of them is a kind of command to initialize everything, so to remember and to locate all applications, to locate all aspects, and then begin aspecting. And so by a comfortable set of console style, of course, menus, you can select or undo any of the actions. You can visualize the fragments of the source in console mode. Join points or possible join points. You can, in this mode, in this tool, you can, again, like an aspect.net framework, you can select or unselect or accept or reject any of the join points. And then finally, you can view, and due to some items of the menu, you can run original application and run updated application and know the difference. So what aspects weaving did. I think so. Time of my talk is over now, so I'm ready to answer any of your questions, and I am ready to demo. Probably, Mark, if possible, probably after my talk right now or in a few minutes, because we will have a break or during this break. It's up to you. So thank you very much for your attention.
I just have a fairly general question. You said in the beginning that aspects help make software more modular, easy to maintain, and so on. Do you have evidence for that?
Sorry, what kind of examples can I give?
Experience showing that aspects actually help, other than to produce papers.
Actually, I can mention or notice experience of other using other AOP tools like AspectJ. Because so there are a lot of articles about that. For example, I do know that, so as an expert in Java technology, AspectJ helped to find a lot of bugs and swing, which is written in Java. And so then instrument a lot of code and a lot of commercial products. There is a special site or a special mailing tool which sends mail about that, about using aspects primarily, of course, within the framework of Java technology. So actually, up to now, AOP was used with Java or together with Java language only. And probably our tool, I hope so, that it will be helpful as probably first or one of the first to help .NET developers to use AOP for their day-to-day activity. But actually, I can just present my general considerations why AOP helps. So if I need to add a new functionality, I can describe it as an aspect. So at this design stage, I can think about weaving rules. It means that I will have and use a systematic view how to apply that functionality. And so using aspects, or due to using aspects, I can try to make this aspect a reusable component to be applied not only to one application, to one compiler, for example, or to some, or to many applications, and so on. These are my general considerations about that. And of course, maintenance can be also done with the help of AOP. But I am more skeptical in this point because of maintenance. But it probably can help to locate some places, but it should be done very carefully. Of course, it doesn't mean that we need to construct an aspect for fixing each bug. It is not realistic. But probably we should rather develop an aspect to add any new useful functionality. And in future, I think that a library of useful aspects can be developed to be applied to probably to many applications. But actually, I should say that even so, in AspectJ and in our tool right now, so one of the open questions is how to locate aspects and what are the conditions, how to locate them. And they should contain some probably formal semantics, not just wildcards. Because we use wildcards, a kind of wildcards, but we allow users to manually, if needed, to manually select or unselect possible join points to avoid blind weaving. In AspectJ, it is not possible, unfortunately. So this is my answer. I'm sorry if I have not answered. Just my considerations about that.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.